Jesus' name, amen. All right. The more common word that we know for betrothed is engaged to be married. Okay, this, but it means much more in the Hebraic understanding. For today's message, I'm building on a foundation of two other messages that I have, you know, taught previously, and I'm bringing them together, okay? Foundation, brick upon brick. So the two messages that I preach is, the first one is the bride made herself ready. I think this was, I don't know how many years ago, but it's a long time. And then the other one is about 2 weeks ago, rightly dividing the word of God. So let me recap on the bride that made herself ready. Okay, in the betrothed, there are many phases, at least three, but I'm not going to go through all of them, but I want to go concentrate on the betrothed phase. So the betrothed phase is that you have the bridegroom to be, and he prepares a covenant, which is the ketubah. They call it ketubah, which is the terms for the marriage. So you see, the ketubah is actually the holy scriptures for us. That is the word of God. All right? And then another important aspect of the betrothal phase is the proposal of the bride price. So if the covenant with its term and the bride price is accepted by both the girl and the father, then the young man would pour out a cup of wine for his beloved. So those who have been studying the series of covenant with me, you will, it is a refresh, you know, refreshing for you, Ruth. So the girl will take this cup, and she drinks from it. So the moment she takes the cup and drinks from it, she is saying she is committed to the covenant and all the terms of the covenant, okay? So at this point, they are betrothed. The moment she picks up the cup and drinks, they are betrothed already. Now, in the Hebraic culture, when they do that in the ancient times, when they do that, they are already legally married. But the consummation of their marriage does not happen until later. So the moment we accepted Christ and when we do the communion, we are actually saying that we are committed to you, Jesus, and all the terms of the covenant in the Bible. Ah, that's betrothed. Meanwhile, the bridegroom goes away to prepare a place in his father's house. Now, that's why we need the Hebraic roots, because otherwise we are going to understand many things about marriage from a Western mindset, but we don't understand the mind of the Bible, which is the Hebraic mindset. So from then onwards, you know, when the bridegroom goes away, the bride puts on a veil. She puts on a veil to tell other men that she is no longer available. Then the bride immediately, not procrastinating, but she immediately prepares herself and her bridesmaid according to the terms of the covenant, which is the word of God. Because she has no idea when the young man is going to come and take her. Now, we see the parallels, right? The parallels of what I've just shared with us accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. So when we accepted that Jesus, he becomes our bridegroom. So the price that Jesus paid, the bride price that Jesus paid was his blood. It's a costly thing. So the covenant with its terms is the Bible. The Bible is the infallible word of God. I think on Thursday I was saying, emphasizing that, you know, you can talk about many things, but it is important that you talk about the word of God, because the word of God is the one that's going to prepare us, and it is going to prepare the bridesmaids that we are also preparing. Now, Not only is Jesus our bridegroom, but he is the living word. So even though God has written and given us this Bible physically, but we have to understand when we accepted Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, he becomes a bridegroom, but he is also the living word that we have accepted. Huh? So every time when we have our communion, it is more than remembering his death and resurrection. It's more than that, okay? And because there is also a reminder that we are accepting the terms of his covenant when we partake of the cup. So every time we drink that cup, we are saying, Jesus, you are my bridegroom. I am accepting the covenants, the terms of the covenant in his word. Many of us grew up taking communion and not know what it is. We just take it. It is so much more inside what we are taking. And it also reminds us that we are betrothed to him and he to us. It's a reminder every time. So next week we are going to have the Holy Communion because it's the first Saturday of the month. Remember, it's more than remembering his death and resurrection. It's remembering that we are committed to his covenant. This in the Bible. And also to remember, when we are betrothed to him, we have the veil on already. That means we are no longer available for the world. Come on now. 1 John chapter 2, 15 to 17 asserts this point. It says here, do not love the world or the things of the world. If someone loves the world, then the love of the Father is not in him. That's serious. Because all the things of the world, the desires of the old nature, the desires of the eyes, and the pretensions of life are not from the Father, but from the world. And the world is passing away along with its desires, but whoever does God's will remains forever. So as noted earlier, to be betrothed is a good, you know, it's as good as being legally, spiritually married. And the spiritual consummation that we have with Jesus, our bridegroom, is when he comes again, hallelujah, to take us to that place that he has prepared in his Father's house. The reason why he does not know it is in the Hebraic culture, it is the Father who tells, okay, now it's time to go and get your bride. That's why even Jesus doesn't know, only his Father knows. And that's why we are given his word to prepare. And I mentioned in the opening prayer when I was teaching on rightly dividing the word of God 2 weeks ago, you know, that when we are betrothed to God, who is Yahweh, we are betrothed to his word because Jesus is a living word. It cannot be separated. So the main point here is to be serious, to be a serious student of God's word. How many of you have started being serious since that time? Huh? How many of you? Because I gave you a whole list that you can study. Be serious student of God's word. We have been drinking milk far too long. We have been drinking milk far too long. It is time to be serious student of the word and chew on the word of God. Chew on the meat of God's word. Every time you eat meat, you can remind yourself, I need to chew on the word of God. You know, no more. I mean, you can have milk because we still need the basics of God's word, but let us chew on that. Jesus is the word, and thus he is inseparable from the word. We cannot say that we love the Lord, but we do not love his word. Come on now. How many believers have told me, you know, it's boring. It's so hard. But Jesus, you cannot divide Jesus from the Word because He's the living Word. Come on. We cannot say that. To love His Word means to seek. Even you don't understand, you seek and seek. The Bible says seek. And you will find. In the end, you will find. So you will seek to know and understand His Word. Trust and obey His Word. His Word is like love letter to us. If you receive a love letter from your friend, well, I don't mean to put you guys in a spot where you don't have love letters, but look at this as a love letter. But if you have a love letter, a precious letter, maybe from your mother whom you love so much, or from your father, or a best friend, you treasure that letter, and many times you will read and read. You may not understand certain things the first time, but you will read again. You won't part from it. This is why God gave us the ketubah. It is His love letter to us. Why? Because He knows we are on a long journey. We are waiting for Jesus to come. But before He comes, we are on this journey of preparation. So He gives us His Word so that we have a guide. It is His guide for us through the life that we are walking through. Maybe through wilderness, maybe through storms, maybe through happy times. But it is His love letter to us telling us, I'm coming back. My letter for you is to show you I am coming back. Hallelujah. So His laws and His commandments are all His loving instruction. We always see law as like, oh, why does He give us all these laws? You know, only a rebellious heart. Only a rebellious heart will not want His laws. I want you to think about that. His laws are and commandments are His loving instruction. So that He wants us to prepare according to His law, so that we know how to live with Him when right here on earth, all the way to eternity, and also to know how to live with each other. The stories in the Bible are there to inspire us, teach us, and to warn us about things, mistakes that they have made that we don't make it again. So today I want you to do an honest evaluation. Honest evaluation of your love for Jesus. How much are you preparing yourself to be a bride, that bride fit for the bridegroom? Think about that. How much do you love His Word? And walking in His Word, you know, will show how much you love Him. How much you endeavor to keep the terms of His covenant, the ketubah, shows how much you are seriously preparing yourself as bride and preparing others as bridesmaids to take on this journey to God. The bridesmaid. Who are the bridesmaid? The bridesmaid are those you bring to the kingdom of God and you prepare them. Like, I'm preparing you. You are like bridesmaid. I'm preparing you so that you too will go to heaven, to that place that Jesus has already prepared. How many bridesmaids do you have? How many do you have? And if you have them, are you faithful to help prepare them? Let us take a closer look into Hosea chapter 2, 19 to 20. And in some version is 21 to 22. Slide 5, yeah, thank you. So the first thing said about betrothed is that he will betroth us to him forever. The story of Hosea symbolizes God's love and commitment to his beloved. So you see how Hosea redeems his wife over and over again. I mean, how many times if I run away from Gordon and prostitute myself, will Gordon go redeem me back? But that's how God loves us. How much have we gone after the world? And yet God is still calling us back. Calling us back. That's his love. He betrothed us to him forever. There is nothing temporary about this divine marriage covenant. It is everlasting. It is not a marriage covenant of convenience. There are many redefinition of marriage today. You don't just leave and walk out. If we want to be established in God's presence and love, we do not walk in and out of his presence and his words, the term of his covenant. One day we decide to obey the terms, next day we decided not to because we are feeling we don't want to. The marriage covenant is sealed with the blood of Jesus. The plan of God's salvation that he has provided us through Jesus is not to be taken lightly. Otherwise, we will be trampling on the blood of Jesus. In the book of Hebrews, it says that there is no other salvation. You walk away from it. There is no other salvation by which we can be saved to this extent where the power of sin will be broken. So treasure this inheritance of salvation, especially given by the Father who loves us so much. Amen. The second point from Hosea, slide 6, it says that he will betroth us to him with righteousness. We were made righteous through the blood of Jesus. And I'm going to expound on Isaiah 54, verse 14 to 17. 54, verse 17, 14 to 17 from the Complete Jewish Bible describes what it is like to be established in his presence. We're going to read. In righteousness, you will be established, far from oppression, with nothing to fear, far from ruin, for it will not come near you. Any alliance that forms against you will not be my doing. Whoever tries to form such an alliance will fall because of you. It is I who created the craftsman who blows on the coals and forges weapons suited for their purpose. I also created the destroyer to work havoc. No weapon made will prevail against you. In your court, you will refute every accusation. Hallelujah. The servants of Adonai inherit all this. The reward for their righteousness is from me, says Adonai. So there is this broadness and depth of his love for us. Wow. He will betroth us to him with all these benefits found in his righteousness. What was that? It says that you will be far from oppression. That's part of his, benefits found in his righteousness. You will be far from oppression. There's nothing to fear. You will be far from ruin. You know, it will not come near you. Any alliance that people build against you, those alliances will fall because of you. Hallelujah. Get excited, man. And no weapon, weapon made against you will prevail. And in the court, every accusation will be refuted. These are some of the benefits in righteousness with God. The question is, do we love him enough to allow His righteousness to be established in our lives. Huh. Paul tells us in Philippians 2, verse 12, he says that to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. We are not saved by works. Okay? We have to make sure that is clear. But after we are saved, the fruits of salvation should become more and more. Oh, sorry. Oh, honey. Oh, sorry. It's okay. So we are not saved by works, but after we are saved, the fruit of salvation should become more and more established and evident in our lives through the help of the Holy Spirit. We should have that. A third thing, slide 7. He will betroth us to him with justice. We are made right and just by the blood of the Lamb. We note earlier that any alliance formed against us will fall, okay? So all these other benefits that we get in righteousness with God, the same inheritance of justice is also available to us. This, that inheritance of justice for us because we are betrothed to him. So he not only made us right with him, made us just with him. Justice is part of our inheritance, like righteousness. Wow. So if somebody deals with you unjustly, know that our beloved is our justice. He gives us that benefit. Hallelujah. Psalms 85, verse 10 to 14 says this about justice. Grace and truth have met together. Justice and peace have kissed each other. In some version, that peace is actually shalom. Truth springs up from the earth and justice looks down from heaven. Adonai the Lord will also grant prosperity. Our land will yield its harvest. Now, justice will walk before him and make his footsteps a path. That's awesome. Justice and peace or shalom goes together. They go together. When there is justice, there is also peace, right? We live in this land because right now there are things that has been in place that where there is justice, that's why we live in peace. We pray that it will be so, that justice will always be in this country. But we don't take that for granted, you know. Justice and peace is the result of grace and truth meeting together. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Justice looks down from heaven, and justice will walk before us. Whoa! Justice will walk before us and make our footsteps a path. Yeah. We are made right or just with God through the shed blood of Jesus. Remember, that's the bright price that Jesus paid for us. All these are paid because of the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. And now we have peace with God because through Jesus we have been reconciled to the Father. So justice and shalom is our inheritance because we are betrothed to Jesus and Jesus is betrothed to us. Yes! Hey, I'm excited. The fourth thing in slide 8, he says, He will betroth me to him with covenant loyalty. God made a covenant with himself in Messiah Jesus for us. Jeremiah chapter 32, 38 to 41 says this. They will be my people, and I will be their God. I will give them singleness of heart and singleness of purpose, so that they will fear me forever. This will be for their own good and for the good of their children after him. I will make with them an everlasting covenant to turn away from them, but to do good. I will put fear of me in their hearts so that they will not leave me. I will take joy in them so that they do so as to do them good. I will plant them in this land truly with my whole heart and being. We were once not a people because we are Gentiles. But God in Christ grafted us in. We were wild olive trees, but God brought the branch of the wild olive tree and grafted us into the true olive wine, the vine. So in the covenant God made with himself for us, it speaks about his commitment to us. God made us his people, and he decided to make himself God to us. He don't have to take care of us, but he decided to choose us and be our God. Sometimes we think, nothing significant about it. But if you really think, why did he want to choose us anyway? It is an everlasting covenant. So here, it's not only everlasting. He is committed to do good for us and for our children after us with all his heart and being, because it is an everlasting covenant. It's not just for us. He wants to bring that benefit to our children, our children's children, and all down the generation. You know, if in our generation we will hold fast to God, then God's mercy and grace goes on to our children. And hopefully we prepare them enough so that they themselves will begin to lay hold of this covenant with God, and they will continue. Amen. We have a job to do. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, it says here that we are to love him with all our heart, soul, and mind. You see, he's totally committed to us. He does all these good things out of his love, out of all his heart and being. And so he's asking us to have that same commitment to him. Doing good for us is his joy and delight. But sometimes we make him look like he's such a mean guy. But he's not. We just didn't understand his ways. He's committed to give us singleness of heart and purpose after him, and to fear him if we let him. You see, because he knows we are forgetful people. He knows because of our sin nature that we will always turn away. But he said, I have chosen to be your God, and I will put my heart, my laws, my everything inside of you so that you won't run away anymore and get into trouble. But when we look at it, sometimes it said, God, you're just making us miserable, giving us all these laws, circumcise our hearts and put laws. You're just wanting us to obey you like slaves. But we miss the point. We miss the point that he wants to put all this in our hearts so that we will not be in the danger of running away because of our sin nature and fall into trouble. That's how much God loves us. God is more willing to help us in this area than we are willing to let him. Why? Because it's so painful. Why? Because we want to hold on to some of the things that we desire. Lord, help us. If we are truly honest with ourselves, many times we are not truly committed to the things of God. Especially when we don't like doing some of the things he tells us to do. And maybe it's because it's so inconvenient, so we don't want to be committed, you know. Or maybe we just don't have the mood today. You know, I don't feel like doing it today. Or maybe because we're just plain lazy. Loyalty is commitment. We have forgotten how to be loyal. Every time we are not wholehearted, single-mindedness in our love and commitment to God, there is definitely another love in our lives. I'm going to repeat that. Every time we are not wholehearted or single-mindedness in our love and commitment to God, there is definitely another love in our lives, or maybe more. It can be as subtle as loving sleep. Sleep becomes your love, your lover. Cleaning house, your house has become your lover. Loving to be in the company of other people more, people have become your loves. Or maybe watching your favorite TV show. The TV has become your lover. It's so subtle. May I go on? I probably don't want to. Be honest with ourselves. Why are you not committed? Why are you like one day you committed, next day you're not, 1 week, 1 month you're committed, and then you're not? There's definitely, definitely other loves in your life. Is our love for Jesus one of loyal commitment? Are we willing to have a singleness of heart to Jesus and a singleness of purpose for Jesus, our coming bridegroom? He's coming. He's definitely coming. Remember when the betrothed, the bride, puts on the veil. Again, I want to talk about the veil. It signifies that she's no longer available for anything, anybody, but only for the bridegroom. So are there other loves in your life? It could be something good. You know, many leaders are more in love with the things they do in ministry than Jesus himself. Uh-oh. Many great men of God are more in love with their anointing and spiritual gifts than Jesus himself. Uh-oh. Many believers are more in love with the blessings that God has given them than God himself, than Jesus himself. Another uh-oh. And many of us hold on to pride and offenses more than we love Jesus. You're feeling the heat now, just as I had when I was preparing this message. Let us allow him to help us to have singleness of heart to Jesus and singleness of purpose for Jesus, our soon coming King. That's why for a while I used to, you know, worry about, you know, different people, you know, praying, and you know, in the end I'm saying, God, in the end, it's between them and you. They can make all the excuses to me, all they can explain everything to me, but in the end, it's them. It's you and God. That's your covenant. Fifth, slide 9. He will betroth me to him with compassion. God remembers his covenant of love for us. He does not forget. Isaiah chapter 54, verse 8 to 10. I was angry for a moment and hid my face from you, but with everlasting grace, I will have compassion on you, says Adonai, your Redeemer. For me, this is the Noah's flood. It is like Noah's flood. Just as I saw, no flood like Noah would ever again cover the earth. So now I swear that never again will I be angry with you or rebuke you. For the mountains may leave and the hills be removed, but my grace will never leave you, and my covenant of peace will not be removed, says Adonai, who has compassion on you. Isaiah 57, verse 16 to 17 tells us that, you know, God knows how much we can take. Even if he's angry with us, remember, it's only for a moment, because his love for us is an everlasting grace for us. Hallelujah. What a comfort. So we need to get over those times of failure and stop beating ourselves up, because if God is no longer angry with you, he has received you and, you know, and forgiven you and cleansed you. So stop it. Stop going back there. In his mercy and loving kindness, which is his grace, he reaches out to us in compassion. You see, he knows that he's the only one that can intervene and bring us out of the pit that we dug for ourselves and we fell into. How many pits have we dug for ourselves and we fell in? And we knew only God in his compassion can take us out. Yeah, of course, there are other, you know, people can do that. But there are many times it's our own fault. We dug that pit ourselves and we fell into. Sometimes we dug it for other people because we want them to fall. But we fell inside ourselves. Isn't that true? And here comes God with his compassion. When we cry out to him, he takes us out. Hallelujah. What an awesome God we have. He says that though the mountains may leave and the hills be removed, his compassion will never leave us, nor be removed, because he has betrothed himself to us. Hallelujah. Oh, may you really love, begin to have a deeper love for God after today. Six, this will be the last point, but I do have quite a bit more to cover, so it's not the end yet, okay? Not fooling you, it's not like 5 minutes more, okay? But in respect to the Hosea exegesis, so he will betroth me to him with faithfulness. God made a covenant with himself in Messiah Jesus for us. So even when we are unfaithful to his covenant, he remains faithful to his covenant. Now, sometimes we think, well, God did this for us because we are so good. But actually, he was just being faithful to his own covenant. Wake up! Because there are some people think that, you know, things are okay with them, you know, so they must be doing it right. But actually, it is just God being faithful to the covenant himself when you have not been faithful. Because he made the covenant with himself for us. So in this verse, Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 6, it describes his faithfulness in going with us, and he will not fail or abandon us. God is always with us. No matter how hard that journey is, he says he will go with us. That's why he gave us his spirit. That's why Jesus had to go back to heaven, so that he can send his spirit, that every one of us have his spirit. So no matter where we go, he goes with us. We're not going alone. And he will not fail us or abandon us. Be strong. Be bold. Don't be afraid or frightened of them, for Adonai, your God, is going with you. He will neither fail you nor abandon you. Joshua chapter 1, verse 5 says this: no one will be able to withstand you as long as you live. Wow, what a promise there. Just as I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will neither fail you nor abandon you. So we see in this verse that we see another aspect of God's faithfulness. He will make sure that no one will be able to withstand us as long as we live. Isn't that awesome? Nobody. That is why we don't have to be afraid or frightened. We hear all these things about what is going to come, you know, all these frightening things about the end times. But we know from this verse that no one will be able to withstand us as long as we live. What a promise in this end times. Hallelujah. But we have to trust him and lean on him, not leaning on our own understanding and our own might. He is our beloved, and we are his beloved. I'm sure Gordon will not allow someone to beat me up. I'm sure he's going to be there for me.
Just looking. It reminds me of my cousin. You know, I have this cousin. He looks like, well, he's tough, you know. And he said, you know, he looks tough. He has all these marks of, you know, marks in a sense like character, like he's, you know, able to fight, you know. And so I said, oh, good, you know. I'll have you as somebody who will escort me when I go, you know, to ATM, you know, just jokingly. And he said, okay, I'll go with you. But if, he said, if somebody starts wanting to attack, I'll run first. You take care of yourself. But God is not like that. Hallelujah. But I love this cousin of mine. He's so precious to me. But of course, he was joking. I know that he will stand for me. Yeah. In fact, today he sent me a very humorous eclipse that I'll show you if you're all interested. So
knowing how much God loves us in Jesus, our response to him is to love him with all our heart, soul, and mind. So like I said earlier, God is so committed to us with all his heart. He's committed to us with all his heart, his whole being. And now he's just asking us to respond with that same fervor of commitment to him. Jesus is the living word, and that means if we love Jesus, we love his word. So the same fervor for his word, you cannot divide the two. John chapter 15 verse 7 says, if you remain united with me and my words with you, then ask whatever you want and it will happen for you. That's such a great promise there. You know, there are many people asking God for things. They want breakthroughs. They want this. They want that. But they are not honoring the covenant with God. They are not being committed to him. And yet, God blesses. Why? Because of his covenant. He's faithful to his covenant, not because you did good or we did good. God's word includes his commandments. So we cannot pick and choose which verse we like and ignore others. Jesus is the word, is a totality. Jesus is not an inanimate object where you pick and choose, you know, which part of him you like or don't like. We love him as a whole. He is a living presence. His word is the path of us discovering more about him so that we will be able to love him with all our heart, our soul, our might. It's all here to teach you how to love him more. We need the whole counsel of God's word, you know, to lead us to love him as he loves us. If we read the word of God, but it does not lead us to love him more, then we have missed the point. We have missed God's point. If we do so much in ministry and it does not lead us to love God more, then we also miss the point. If we faithfully go to church week after week, but it does not lead us to love God more, we miss the point. Oh. If we tithe and give offerings faithfully, but it does not lead us to love God more, we miss the point. The word of God is the ketubah, the terms of the covenant. It prepares us to be his bride who learns to love the bridegroom more and more, even while he is away, preparing a place for us in his father's house. I remember one of the summers when I went, I remember saying to, you know, the church, I said, I will be away on mission. Okay, that doesn't mean the cat is away, the mouse comes out to play. Do you remember that? Jesus is away, but he's definitely coming back for us. What are we doing? Are we mouse playing around? Jesus, God in Jesus, has already loved us while we